गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल, दिस इज केपीएच नली कुमारी पीजीटी बॉटनी केजीबी पुल्लल चेरुवु फ्रम प्रकाशम डिस्ट्रिक्ट एंड नाउ आई विल टेल यू अबाउट दी चैप्टर 4 दैट इज फोटोसिंथेसिस इन हायर प्लांट्स. इन द प्रीवियस क्लास आई टोल्ड अबाउट इन दिस टॉपिक 4 टॉपिक्स आई टोल्ड दैट इज व्हाट डू वी नो अबाउट फोटोसिंथेसिस एंड वेयर डज दिस फोटोसिंथेसिस अकर्स एंड how many pigments are present in this photosynthesis. And now I will tell in this class, I tell you about the next topic. It is what is light reactions. In the previous class, I told about the what is meant by light reactions. And these light reactions, they are present in the stroma of the enzymatic reactions which incorporate the carbon dioxide into the plant which leads into the synthesis of the sugar. This entire process takes place in the, they are directly light driven, hence they are called as a light reactions. So once again I will tell, where does this light reactions take place? In the stroma of the enzymatic reactions which incorporate the carbon dioxide into the plant. The whole entire process, they are directly light driven, hence they are called as a light reactions. And in these light reactions, they are also called as a photochemical phase. And in these light reactions, it includes light absorption, water switching, and oxygen. And once again, I will tell, in these light reactions, light absorption, water switching, and oxygen also include. So, in these light reactions, so many pigments are also organized. In these light reactions, so many pigments are organized to discrete photochemicals, that is light harvesting complexes. In these light reactions, so many pigments are organized into two discrete photochemicals, that is light harvesting complexes. Within these light harvesting complexes, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2 are present. In these light harvesting complexes, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2 are present. And these are also, in these light harvesting complexes, it is made up of hundreds of pigment molecules. These light harvesting complexes, it is made up of hundreds of pigment molecules which bonds to proteins. And in this, each photosystem, in this light harvesting complex, it is made up of two photosystems, no? And in these, each photosystems, they has all the pigments forming a light harvesting system. It also called as a antenna. It also called antenna. And in these, the pigments, these pigments are helped there to make the photosynthesis more efficient by absorbing different wavelengths of light. In these light harvesting complexes, the pigments, it helps to make the photosynthesis by more efficient by absorbing different wavelengths of light. And in this light harvesting complex, a special chlorophyll A, it forms the reaction centers. And in this light harvesting complex, a special chlorophyll A, it forms the reaction centers. And these reaction centers is different in both the photosystems. And in this light harvesting complex, I told you two photosystems are present, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. And in these reaction centers is different in both the photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. How they are different? In photosystem 1, the reaction center of the chlorophyll A, it has an absorption peak, it has 700 nanometers that we named it as a P7, photosystem 700, that is P700. And in photosystem 2, the reaction centers, it has an absorption maxima at 680 and it is named as a photosystem P680. So these are different in both the photosystems. And in this light harvesting complex, a special chlorophyll A, it is present, that is we called as a reaction centers. And this chlorophyll reaction centers is different in both the photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. And in these light reactions, it is also include light absorption, water switching, and oxygen. And in this light reactions, so many pigments, hundreds of pigments are bound to proteins. And this in this light harvesting complexes, these pigments, it helps to make the photosynthesis more efficient by absorbing the different wavelengths of light. And in this light reactions, these pigments are organized to discrete the photosystems. In this the light reactions, the pigments, they are organized to discrete the photochemicals into the light harvesting complexes. And in this light harvesting complex, it includes within the photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. And now I will show these the diagram of this light reactions. In this light reaction, if you see in this diagram, see the primary acceptor is there, and in this photon, and is this reaction center. See, the reaction center is there, and it has a special chlorophyll A. It has a special chlorophyll A. It forms the reaction center, and this reaction center, it is different in both the photosystems, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. How they are different? In photosystem 1, we named as a P700, and in photosystem 2, we named as a P680. And in this light reactions, so many hundreds of pigment molecules are present. And these pigments, it helps to make the photosynthesis more efficient by absorbing different wavelengths of the light. And now I will tell what are the important events present in the light reactions. The important events present in the light reactions, they are the light absorption and photolysis end products of ATP, NADPH and oxygen. In the important events of light reactions are light absorption, photolysis end products of ATP, NADPH and oxygen. And in this, first one is the light absorption. In this, in this light absorption, so many pigment, hundreds of pigment molecules are present. These pigment molecules, it absorbs the light. And in this light absorption, the chlorophyll A, it contains how many system? Two photosystems, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. And these two photosystems, they are different in their reaction centers. And the photosystem 1, in the reaction centers are P700. And in photosystem 2, the reaction center is P680. And the process of the formation of ATP and in the presence of light, we called as a photophosphorylation. What is meant by photophosphorylation? And this photophosphorylation, it is of two types. They are cyclic photophosphorylation and non-cyclic photophosphorylation. So this is about the light absorption. And in this light absorption, once again I will tell, in this light absorption, so many pigments are involved, and these pigments absorbs the light. And in this light absorption, the chlorophyll A, it contains two photosystems, that is photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. And these two photosystems, they are different in their reaction centers. Reaction centers, what is meant by reactions? Where does these reaction centers are present? In the light harvesting complexes. In the light harvesting complexes, it has a special chlorophyll. We call it as a reaction centers. And these reaction centers, they are different in both the photosystems, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. In photosystem 1, the reaction centers is P700, and in photosystem 2, the reaction center is P680. And what is meant by photophosphorylation? The process of formation of ATP in the presence of light, we call it as a photophosphorylation. And this photophosphorylation, it is of two types, cyclic photophosphorylation and non-cyclic photophosphorylation. And now I will show that the diagram of this cyclic photophosphorylation. This is the diagram of the cyclic photophosphorylation. So in this diagram, see, if you see the cyclic phosphorylation, formation of ATP due to cyclic flow of electrons in photosystem 1 is called as a cyclic photophosphorylation. What is meant by cyclic photophosphorylation? The formation of ATP due to cyclic flow of electrons. Formation of ATP due to cyclic flow of electrons in photosystem 1 we called as a cyclic photophosphorylation. And in this cyclic photophosphorylation, it takes place in the photosystem 1. That means photosystem 1, it has a wavelength P 700 nanometers. So in this cyclic photophosphorylation, it takes place only in the photosystem 1. And in this photosystem 1, it has a reaction centers P 700 nanometers. During this process, the electrons from photosystem 1, they are conveyed to the electron acceptors. If you see in this diagram, the electron acceptors are also there. During this process, the electrons from photosystem 1, photosystem C, see in the first, the electrons from the photosystem 1, they are conveyed into the electron acceptors. And the excited electrons, it is cycled back to photosystem 1 through electron transport system. These electrons is cycled. Again, these electrons are cycled back to photosystem 1 through electron transport systems. This cyclic flow, it results in the synthesis of the ATP. This flow of this cyclic means the electrons flowing of the, it results in the synthesis of ATP. So, this is about the cyclic photophosphorylation. What is meant by cyclic photophosphorylation? Formation of ATP due to cyclic flow of electrons. In photosystem 1, they are called as a cyclic photophosphorylation. How these electrons flow in the photosystems? Now I'll tell. In this electrons, the cyclic photophosphorylations, it takes place only in the photosystem 1. And in this photosystem 1, it has a reaction centers P700. And it has a wavelength of 700 nanometers. During this process of the electrons from photosystem 1, they are conveyed to the electron acceptors. So, and again, these electrons is cycled back to the photosystem 1 through electron transport system. So, these electrons, they are cycled back to photosystem 1 through electron transport system. By this cyclic flow, it results in the formation of the synthesis of the ATP. So, this is about the cyclic photophosphorylation. If you see in the cyclic photophosphorylation diagram, it takes place in the photosystem 1, and from this photosystem 1, the electrons are conveyed to the electron acceptors, and in these electrons, they are again cycled back to the photosystem 1 through electron transport system. So the entire process, it takes place in the cyclic way, and then it results in the synthesis of the ATP. And next one is the non-cyclic photophosphorylation. And in this non-cyclic photophosphorylation, it takes place in the photosystem 2 and photosystem 1, they are involved in the non-cyclic photophosphorylation. In photosystem 2, that is the reaction centers is P680, and it has a wavelength 680 nanometers. And in this, the photosystem 1, it releases the electrons which are picked up by the electron acceptors. Where does this photosystem 1, it releases? In the cyclic photophosphorylation. In cyclic photophosphorylation, in photosystem 1, the electrons are released and they are picked up by the electron acceptor. And at the same time, P700 of photosystem 1, they also get excited by receiving a light ray of 700 nanometers. And this photosystem 1, it releases electrons which reduces NADP to NADPH. So, these electrons are traveling in the shape of a jet shape in the non-cyclic photophosphorylation. So, they are named as a jet scheme. And in this non-cyclic photophosphorylation, first, this non-cyclic photophosphorylation takes place in the photosystem 2. Then this photosystem 2, the reaction centers is the P680 and it has a wavelength is 680 nanometers. And in this non-cyclic photophosphorylation, photosystem 1, in cyclic photophosphorylation, in photosystem 1, the electrons are released and they are picked up by the electron acceptors. I already show in the diagram. And at the same time, this P700 of photosystem 1, they also get excited by receiving the light ray of 700 nanometers. And in during this process, the photosystem 1, it releases the electrons and which reduces the NADP and N2 NADPH. So this by these electrons are traveling in this non-cyclic photophosphorylation, these electrons are traveling in a jet shape. These electrons are traveling in a jet shape, so they are named as a jet scheme. So by traveling the electrons in this non-cyclic photophosphorylation and for cyclic photophosphorylation in the shape of a jet, hence they are named it as a jet scheme. So this is about the cyclic and non-cyclic photophosphorylation. Once again I will tell what is meant by photophosphorylation. The process of formation of ATP in the presence of light is called photophosphorylation. This photophosphorylation is of two types. How many types? Two types. For cyclic photophosphorylation and non-cyclic photophosphorylation. And in this cyclic photophosphorylation, what is meant by cyclic photophosphorylation? Formation of ATP due to cyclic flow of electrons in photosystem 1, it is called as a cyclic photophosphorylation. Formation of ATP due to cyclic flow of electrons in photosystem 1, it is called as a photophosphorylation. And in this cyclic photophosphorylation, the electrons are released and is picked up into the by the electron acceptors. And in this cyclic photophosphorylation, the reaction center is P700 and its wavelength is 700 nanometers. And the next one is the non-cyclic photophosphorylation. This non-cyclic photophosphorylation, it takes place in the photosystem 2. And this in this photosystem 2, it has a reaction center, it is P680 nanometers. And this wavelength is 680 nanometers. And in this non-cyclic photophosphorylation, the electrons are released in the photosystem 1. They are picked up by the electron acceptors. And these electrons, the excited of the photosystem 1, they are also releases electrons which reduces the NADP to NADPH. And see, these electrons, they are traveling in the jet shape, hence they are named as a jet scheme. So this is about the light reactions. So once again I will tell what is meant by light reaction. Where does this light reaction occurs? This light reaction occurs in the stroma of the enzymatic reactions which incorporate the carbon dioxide of the plant. And this entire setup of the reactions takes place, they are directly light driven, hence they are called as a light reactions. And in these light reactions, light absorption, water splitting and oxygen are involved. And in these light reactions, so many pigments are involved to form a two discrete photosynthesis, that is light harvesting complexes. And in these light harvesting complexes, two photosystems are involved, that is photosystem 1 and photosystem 2. And in these photosystem 1 and photosystem 2, and in this light harvesting complexes, so many pigments are involved to make the photosynthesis. It helps the photosynthesis more efficient by absorbing different wavelengths of the light. And in this light harvesting complexes, a special chlorophyll A is present that we called as a reaction centers. What are the important events present in these light reactions? They are the light absorption, photolysis, and products are ATP and NADPH and oxygen. And last one is the photolysis of water. And this photolysis of water, in this photolysis of water, the first step of the electrons are removed from the photosystem 1. And they are recharged by the photosystem 2 and losses the, in photosystem 2 it losses the electrons. And in photolysis of water, in the first step of photosystem of 1, it takes place, the electrons are removed from the photosystem 1. And after removing the electrons from photosystem 1, they are recharged by the photosystem 2. And the splitting of the water molecules by oxygen, the evolving complex, it releases the electrons. These electrons are supplied to the photosystem 1. Here, in the first step, the electrons are removed from photosystem 1, no? And that electrons, they are split off the water molecules by oxygen. By evolving the water complex, it releases the electrons. And these electrons, they are supplied to the photosystem 2. And thus, the end products of the light reactions are the ATP, NADPH and the oxygen. These end products, they are shown in the equation 2H2O, that gives rise to 4H plus and oxygen plus 4 electrons. So, this is about the photolysis of water. In this photolysis of water, the first step, it removes the electrons from photosystem 1. After removing the electrons from photosystem 1, they are recharged by the photosystem 2. And now in this photosystem 2, it loses the electrons. And after that losing the electrons, it splits off water molecules by oxygen by evolving a complexes to release the electrons. So these electrons are supplied. The releasing of the electrons in photosystem 2, they are supplied to the photosystem 2. And thus the end products of these light reactions are ATP, NADPH and oxygens. So this is about the light reactions. And light reactions and what is meant by light reactions and what are the important events and end products of the light reactions. What are the end products of the light reactions? ATP, NADPH and oxygens. So these are the end products of the light reactions, ATP, NADPH and oxygen. Next topic, it is the chemiosmotic hypothesis. Now I will show the diagram of this chemiosmotic hypothesis. So this is the diagram of the chemiosmosis. If you see in this diagram, photosystem 1 and photosystem 2 are present. These photosystem 1 and where this photosystem 1, photosystem 2 are present in the light harvesting complexes. And in this photosystem 2 and photosystem 1, and then middle cytochromes B and F are present. And see thylakoid membrane also there. So this is the diagram for the chemiosmosis. Let us, I will tell about this, how this, what are the process for this chemiosmosis. In this, for this chemiosmosis hypothesis, it is proposed by the Michael to explain the ATP synthesis. This chemiosmosis hypothesis, it is proposed by the Michael to explain the ATP synthesis. This ATP synthesis, they are linked for the development of proton gradient across the membrane. This ATP synthesis, they are linked to the development of the proton gradient across the membrane. And in this ATP synthesis, the splitting of water molecules take place on the inner side of the membrane. In this ATP synthesis, splitting of water molecules, they are take place in the inner side of the membrane. And in this inner side of the membrane of the protons are also hydrogen ions that are produced by the splitting of water within the lumen of the thylakoids. These thylakoids, if you see in the diagram, these thylakoids, the outside membrane is the thylakoid membrane. So, in this ATP synthesis, the splitting of water molecules, it takes place on the inner side of the membrane of the protons or hydrogen ions that are produced by the splitting of water accumulate within the lumen of the thylakoids. And in this chemiosmosis hypothesis, the electrons move through the transport chain. In this ATP synthesis, the electrons are moved from the transport chain. By moving these electrons to transport chain, protons also transported across the membrane. By moving these electrons through transport chain, in this the protons also transported across the membrane. and while this moving while the moving of the electrons in the transport chain, the molecules passes into the electrons to electron carrier on the inner side of the membrane. And in this, by moving these electrons in the inner side of the membrane of the proton is released in the inner side. By moving these electrons in the inner side of the membrane, the protons are released into the inner side or lumen of the membrane. So in this diagram, NADP is the, NADP reductase enzyme, it is located in the stroma side of the membrane. The diagram NADP is located, the NADP reductase and enzyme, it is located on the stroma side of the membrane. Along with these electrons, it comes from the acceptor of the electrons of photosystem 1. These protons, they are necessary for the reduction of the NADP to NADPH and hydrogens. This NADP reductase enzyme, where this NADP reductase enzyme is present, it is located in the stroma side of the membrane. Along with these electrons, it comes from the acceptors of the electrons from photosystem 1. And in this, it leads for the necessary for the reduction of NADP plus to NADPH and hydrogen. And in this the protons also removed from the stroma. In this, the protons are also removed from the stroma, and these protons in the stroma, they are decreased in the membrane. They are decreased in membrane with this, these protons gradients across the thylakoid membranes, and the pH is the lumen, and in this, the pH of the lumen is decreases. So in this ATPase, it consists of two parts. In this ATP synthesis, it consists of the two parts. One is F0 and F1. F0 means it is the fundamental frequency. F0, it is embedded in the membrane that forms the transmembrane channel. It carries facilitated diffusion of protons across the membrane. This F0, it is embedded in the membrane that forms the transmembrane channel. It carries the facilitated diffusion of protons across the membrane. And F1, it produces on the outer surface of the thylakoid membrane. F1, it is the fundamental frequency. It is produces in the outer surface of the thylakoid membrane. And this, so this ATP, it consists of two parts, F0 and F1. F0, it is embedded in the membrane that forms the transmembrane channel and which carries the facilitated diffusion of protons across the membrane. It which carries the facilitated diffusion of protons across the membrane. So in F1, it is produces the outer surface of the thylakoid membrane. So this is about the chemiosmotic hypothesis. This it is used to explain the ATP synthesis, where this ATP synthesis, it is linked to the development of the proton gradient across the membrane. And in this ATP synthesis, splitting of water molecules, it takes place on the inner side of the membrane of the protons, or hydrogen ions that are produced of the splitting of water accumulate within the lumen of the thylakoids. Once again, I will repeat this. And in this ATP synthesis, splitting of water molecules takes place in the inner side of the membrane of the protons, or otherwise, hydrogen ions that are produced by the splitting of water which accumulate within the lumen of the thylakoids. And in this ATP synthesis, it consists of two parts, that is F0 and F1. F0, it is embedded in the membrane that forms the transmembrane. This F0, it is embedded in the membrane that forms the transmembrane to carry the facilitated diffusion of protons across the membrane. And F1, it is produces on the outer surface of the thylakoid membrane. F1, it produces the outer surface of the thylakoid membrane. So this is about the chemiosmotic hypothesis. And next topic, it is the where this ATP and NADPH are used. This ATP and NADPH are used in the biosynthetic phase of photosynthesis. And in this biosynthetic, and now I will tell about this biosynthetic pathway is used for the synthesis of the, how it is used for the synthesis of the sugar. This biosynthetic pathway of the So it is used for the synthesis of sugar. It is traced out by the Calvin and Benson. So they are used by the radioactive carbon to on the algal cultures. In the Calvin cycle, it occurs in all photosynthetic plants. This Calvin cycle, it occurs in all the photosynthetic plants. And this Calvin cycle, they are described in the three phases. This biosynthetic pathway, it is used for the synthesis of the sugar, which are traced out by the Calvin and Benson. And in this Calvin cycle, they are described in the three phases. Now I will show the diagram. See, this is the diagram for the Calvin cycle, which is described by the three phases. What are those phases? First one is the carboxylation phase, reduction phase, and regeneration phase. First one is the carboxylation phase, reduction phase, and regeneration phase. This is the diagram of the Calvin cycle. And in this diagram, if you see, then the first one is the carboxylation phase. During this phase, the carbon dioxide combines with a 5 carbon compounds. In this carboxylation phase, the carbon dioxide, it combines with a 5 carbon compound, which are called ribulose 1,5 biphosphate, and it forms 3 phosphoglyceric acid. And in this carboxylation phase, it combines with the carbon dioxide to form a 5 carbon compound, which is called as a ribulose 1,5 biphosphate. And this ribulose 1 biphosphate, it forms the 3 phosphoglyceric acid. It takes place in the carboxylation phase. And next one is the reduction phase. In this reduction phase, during this phase, the carbohydrate is synthesized by assimilating power of the light reaction. In this reduction phase, the carbohydrate, it is synthesized and it is utilized by the assimilating power of the light reactions. Light reactions, that is ATP and NADPH. And next one is the regeneration phase. In this regeneration phase, the carbon dioxide acceptor, it is ribulose 1,5 phosphate, it is formed again to continue the Calvin cycle. And in this regeneration phase, the carbon dioxide acceptor, that is ribulose 1,5 phosphate, it is formed again and it is continued to the Calvin cycle. So this is about the Calvin cycle, takes place in the three phases. First one is the carboxylation phase, and next is the reduction phase and regeneration phase. In carboxylation phase, carbon dioxide combines with the 5 carbon compound to form the ribulose 1,5 bisphosphate, and it forms the 3 phosphoglyceric acid. And in reduction phase, this carbohydrate, it is synthesized by utilizing the assimilatory power of the light reactions. The light reactions are the ATP and NADPH. And last one is the in regeneration phase. In this phase, the carbon dioxide acceptor, that is ribulose 1,5 phosphate, it is again formed to continue the Calvin cycle. So this is about the Calvin cycle, takes place in the three phases. And in the next class, I will explain remaining the topics.